Syrian refugees have been risking their lives to escape their own country due to the war on President Bashar al-Assad and also the threat of Syrian districts being taken over by the extreme terrorist group Islamic State. Hundreds of thousands of Syrians have now fled their country and refugee camps in neighbouring countries to come over to Europe in hope of a safer life.
So, Reverend Holford, what's your current position on the refugee crisis that's happening at the moment?
Well, it's absolutely appalling. The you get daily updates on the news and in papers about the appalling suffering that's being caused to thousands of people who have left their own homes in search of a better life.
So Britain has decided they're going to take 20,000 Syrian migrants. Do you think that's enough morally?
I agree with David Cameron's approach of going to refugee camps because anything that helps people to stop having to cross countries and dangerous waterways and things like that in order to reach safety has to be a good idea. I mean, if I were Prime Minister, which is not terribly likely, I guess I'd be looking at hundreds of thousands. I think there is, from my point of view, a Christian imperative to show compassion, and that compassion should come up well above protecting your own country's economic position or anything else.
On Tuesday, 15th of September, a selection of talented cricketers were invited to a session with Darren Goff. Darren is England's ninth most successful wicket taker and regarded as a model professional. He is also well known for winning the 2005 series of Strictly Come Dancing.
Hello, Barney and Lucy. So what made you apply for the role of Head Boy and Head Girl?
Well, I wanted to go for it because I wanted to get a bit more involved in what happens in the running of the school, so have a say in what actually happens at the top. So when the applications came out, I thought it would be a good way to do it. And I also wanted to give something back to the school, having got so much out of all the things that I've done while I've been here. So, yeah.
I just wanted to represent the school in the way that I think it should be represented, and also to be involved in all the events and, like Barney, some of the running of the school.
So what does it mean to be head boy and head girl?
Essentially what it means is that we are the link between the students and the teachers. So we have a meeting every Monday morning with Miss Hopkins and Mr. Litchfield, where we talk about what's been going on in that week in the students, and then maybe what we think is bubbling up through the students, what they want to be said to the teachers, and maybe what they think is maybe not going so well in terms of the way the school is being run or something that they're not happy with. So, yeah.
What has been the best thing you've done in the role so far?
So this summer we refurbished our sixth form common room. So we basically stripped it back to basics, repainted it. We had a really generous donation of 150 chairs from Phil Oram. We had a mural painted by Georgie Paulus-Neild, who did an incredible job. And we have artwork on the walls and new notice boards, and just made it a really nice area for our sixth form students to socialise in and work.
How are you planning on bridging the gap between the sixth form and the younger years?
Well, we've already mentioned the student-led assemblies, which we'd like to introduce. That would obviously mean that the older faces are a bit more familiar to the younger students. But also, what we've been recently doing is people from the senior school council have been going to meetings of the lower school council and just kind of bridging what's going on between the two. They can tell each other what's going on in both the councils as well, so they become a bit more of a joint council.
When students reach the sixth form, would you recommend that they apply for the role?
Definitely.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's a great thing to be involved in the school, and also it's good for your future prospects, so put it on your CV, job applications. And we're just really proud, aren't we?
Very good.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sam Collins had the once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to jump off a mountain on the 2015 Chamonix trip. Here's the exclusive footage. I believe I can fly. Woo. I believe I can touch the sky. I think about it every night and day. Spread my wings and fly away. I believe I can soar.
13 students undertook the grueling Gold Duke of Edinburgh expedition near the end of the summer holidays. This consisted of a four-day expedition of over 80 kilometres, with them only living off what they carried on their backs and gathering water from streams along the way. Two of the three groups took the demanding trip up Cadair Idris, admiring the beauty of the Snowdonia National Park. All groups completed the expedition and are on course to receive their gold award. In July this year, 17 students went on a once-in-a-lifetime adventure to the Atlas Mountains in Morocco. We spent 16 days in the country, with the first seven being spent trekking around the mountains before finishing the last day atop the highest mountain in North Africa, Mount Toubkal. Once the grueling but rewarding journey around the mountains was over, we travelled out into the Sahara Desert, racing over sand dunes in 4x4s in 45-degree heat. That night we slept outside in the middle of the desert before climbing the tallest sand dune in Morocco to watch the sunrise. The following days gave us a well-earned rest in Sheila Pash, a beautiful hotel on the edge of the desert, before finally travelling back to Marrakesh and spending our final day wandering around the souks and bartering for our presents to bring home. Morocco was an incredible experience that many of us would never have had the opportunity to do if it wasn't for KTS, and every student that went came back with some amazing stories and memories.
Sir Oliver Heald, who recently visited KTS, was very impressed.